So I will show you a typical case that has been presented in the Eurosun conference in La Palma, in Mallorca, 3 weeks ago. So it's regarding the STS-MED project, in which the frontend collector, which is on the other roof, has been built. So this presentation has been prepared with Fabio Maria Montagnino. Yesterday he already performed a nice presentation. So, like Archimedes, he's Sicilian, and myself from Cyprus Institute. So, the project was financed by the European Union through the EMPICDC-MED agency. There were 14 partners from all around the Mediterranean Sea Basin area. So 2 from France, and also the CEA and CEEI Provence, and Consortio ARCA was the coordinator. Enea also was partner, as well as the Sicilian region. So partners from Greece, Cyprus, Egypt, and Jordan. The Cyprus Institute was the leader, the coordinator of the work package 6, which was dedicated to the construction of 4 solar platforms, 3 Frenel and 1 PDC, parabolic. So one of the platforms was in Palermo, another one was in close to Cairo in second, the other one in Nicosia, and one in Al Bakkah University in Jordan. So, first, needs of air conditioning in our regions is really high, as you may know. And we have also many flat roofs. Many of them are flat, and they also align north-south. So, as you saw yesterday, in our region, north-south region can permit to host Frenel collectors or single-axis technologies like parabolic or Frenel collectors. So we decided through this project to construct 4 multi-generative platforms. They are integrated in the built environment. This is the one that we are going to visit this afternoon. So you see it's on the roof of a school. The idea is with these platforms is to produce heat to respond directly to the air conditioning demand through absorption chillers, and also directly heating in winter when we need heat in the buildings. And also these platforms are co-generating. How? By producing electricity, and we'll see how. A huge part of this project was not only building 4 multi-generative platforms, but also to transfer the know-how, so through videos on online, also the dissemination activities, like some of you already participated to some conferences, some lectures, online lectures, visits on site. So here are the 4 solar collectors. So this is the one in Cyprus, the one in Egypt, in Italy, Fabio already showed this one, and the one at Erbil in Jordan. They are all located around the, and as you can see, they have different power capacity. 70 thermal kilowatts at Cyprus Institute, 115 in Egypt, 190 in Italy, and 85 in Jordan. In Cyprus and Jordan, they are both installed in on public buildings, on roofs. In Egypt, it's on plain field, plain ground, close to a medical center. In Italy, it's also in the campus of the University of Palermo. All of them aim to produce air conditioning for public facilities. So it can be school, hospital, university, or offices. These platforms, at least 2 of them from now, are using pyrheliometers. So you saw the technology, I think, two days ago now. So In Cyprus, it's installed on the roof, of this building where we have lunch on this roof, because it's the highest point of, let's say, the area here. It's where we measure the TNI, so the direct normal irradiance. And I will show you, for instance, now. For instance, now in real time, you can see the DNI in its position. So you see the real time DNI now on the roof, it's 640. So 1 millimeter also is installed in Italy, in Palermo, in Arca area. So as you can see, these platforms have been commissioned recently, here in July and in September in Palermo. You can see, for instance, during the commissioning, the values of DNI in Cyprus and in Italy, and also the power we reach, thermal power. We reach 70 kilowatts in Cyprus, almost, and 160 kilowatts thermal in Italy. These platforms use thermal storage. So I think you understood now that with solar energy, concentrated power, thermal storage is really important in order to shift the power production when required. In Cyprus, we simply use pressurized water. We wanted to make it simple, and pressurized water is something which is quite available here on Cyprus market. And we have 2 hours of storage for cooling in summer, and 4 hours of storage for heating in winter. Energy they use directly the heat transfer fluid as thermal storage, so it's thermal oil, terminal 66. In German, they use also thermal oil, and as mentioned just in the previous presentation, in Italy they use this kind of storage here, which is based on a ternary salt mixture, and it has been designed by Enea in Italy at low scale, experience at the low scale dimension, and then expanding to something which is around 8 cubic meters. So the charging line with oil is on the bottom, and the heat migrates on the top, and the discharging line for the power block is on the top. So it's relying on thermocline technology. It's this kind of thermal salt mixture can operate for temperatures required for HVAC, meaning for heating and cooling. For instance, in Cyprus, we are using at Prodias facilities the molten salt that are able to work up to 570 degrees. Here, they work around 140 to 240 degrees. So the melting point is really lower, around 80 degrees. Here you can see this storage here installed in Italy at Palermo. And here is the thermal storage of pressurized water at the Cyprus Institute. And this is the tank of oil in Jordan. So these platforms provide air conditioning. To provide air conditioning for cooling, there are some miracle machines that I will not detail now, but called absorption chillers. Maybe some of you already know the absorption chiller technology. So basically, you have heat, and you provide heat to this machine, and it's giving you cooling. So this is done inside in the 4 platforms. Egypt and Cyprus use a brand called Yazaki with a cooling capacity of 35 kilowatts, so it's quite low. And in Italy, they use the broad one, and overall in Jordan. The COP of these absorption chillers, maybe as you see, is quite low, from 0.6 to 1 for the double effect. That's the main drawback of these machines so far, is that the COP is quite low compared to the classic heat pumps. But you use directly the solar energy to provide cooling. So in a way, you're not paying electricity bill, you're using what you have on site, solar radiation directly provide directly cooling. So this is the one in Cyprus. It's here on the car parking. So you can have a look and you can see at some point if you want to have a walk there. This is the chiller at in Italy. So you see here in Cyprus we use an absorption chiller connected to a cooling tower. So we need to cool this absorption chiller. But in Italy, everything is condensed in only one block. This is a chiller in Jordan. And these absorption chillers are used in summer. And in winter, we can use them, some of them, like in Italy and in Egypt. They also they are also able to provide heating. So they can provide heating simply by bypassing some chambers inside the absorption chiller. In Cyprus, we directly bypass the absorption chiller, so we directly provide heating, like in Jordan as well. So in summer, we produce cooling. In winter, we produce heating. And what in between? That's a main problem, is that you have a big, let's say, Ferrari on your building, and what are you doing during the month that you don't need heating and cooling? So that's a big problem. It's also a problem more here, because it's a public building. So it's an office, so it's an office building. So it means that during the weekends, public holidays, very early morning before 9 and after 5, 6, the cooling load and heating load is either none or either low. So we decided to cogenerate. So to use this facility to improve the capacity factor, it means the length of use during the year, we hybridize the platforms with organic Rankine cycles. So I will not go into details. You know already the Rankine cycle. It's the same technology, but you use now oil, thermal oil, directly produce electricity. So it's a Rankine cycle, and the turbine is generating electricity. So that's the case in Egypt and Italy, and in Jordan. They directly produce steam for a steam turbine. So you see the capacity is quite low. The capacity of the four platforms is 400 kilowatts, 70 kilowatts in Cyprus, and 150 in Egypt, and you see the ORC is only 4.3. It's more a demonstration unit, because as it was pointed out just in the previous presentations, ORC at these scales are still low efficient. So this is the main drawing in Cyprus. So in Cyprus we have this building here, which is the first in Cyprus, at least aiming to become the first nearly to zero energy building. It means that it consumes on site the same amount of energy as it produces on site, almost the same amount of energy that it consumes. So the idea is even to decrease the energy load of this building with the Fresnel collector, providing air conditioning. So here is the Fresnel collector. The Fresnel collector is heating oil. Here, this room. We have a small buffer here. All the time, the buffers are here for expansion purpose, but also it's slightly buffering the thermal production. So you have a smoother release for the thermal storage loop, which is pressurized water. It's not very expensive. It's technology which is quite spread here in Cyprus. So we store the heat only in water up to 146 degrees, and then we have the heat medium loop. Again, we have a small buffer here to stabilize the output for the absorption chiller, which is here. So from the Fresnel collector, we arrive here to the absorption chiller during the summer, and during winter, we bypass it and we directly provide heating to the building through fan coil units and air handling units. And we also produce hot water here for the building. So we can also use that to provide hot water for the mains of water. We are using also a platform that I'm going to show you to control. The loops. internet is not very fast because we're all using the Wi-Fi, so. So hopefully at some point we'll be here. So this is the main drawing of what's happening now on our field. So some sensors are not in real time plotted here. So front end collector, the buffer of oil, thermal storage of water, the heat medium storage which provides heat to the hydrogen shielder, the oxygen shielder, and the bypass system for the winter. So we can have a look here, a rendering of what's happening on our system. At the level of the front end collector. So we have the main rendering that we can show on even online for people who are interested in looking what's happening on our field. And also we can have a partial control with these separated loops. So here you have you can see the loop of thermal oil. So this is the front end collector, this is the outlet temperature of the front end collector, and the buffer of oil. So you see we have thermal sensors a bit everywhere on the roof, so it's more detailed. Here it's a bypass valve, so we have the thermostat function, which is here, and it is based between the temperature, it's based basically on the temperature of the tank here. So we say that we want to reach 140 degrees, and we have a dead band temperature, which is, according to this, low, charging the thermal storage, which is just after the heat exchanger here. So when it's hot enough here, it is bypassing and transferring the heat here. If not, it's a closed loop here, simply just what for heating. During the winter, as well, we have to make sure that the viscosity of the oil is enough. So to increase the viscosity, we have to heat it up more than 50 degrees, let's say. And this way, we can then send the oil directly to the receiver. We have this is a problem we saw during the construction, and mainly in Italy, because the design has been performed in Italy with ARTA. And they saw that during the beginning of the day, when it's hot and high, it's cold, for instance, after a night and you start and you have IDMI, the receiver, the absorber tube, which is inside the vacuum tube, may bend. So here we have simply heaters, electric heaters, that we activate just to preheat the oil.
Excuse me, can I ask a question on anti-leakage? I want just to know that the temperature that when designing the system, like the temperature needed for the cooling system, which temperature you decided to have?
So for the oxygen shielder, it's working from 88 degrees here up to 70. In our case, when we are below 85, we stop the oxygen shielder because efficiency of the oxygen shielder is really reduced when you go to very low temperatures, and also maintenance of oxygen shielder has to be really taken into account because you might risk crystallization and so on. So we work around 90 degrees, let's say. It's a single effect.
And for the design point of the irradiation?
The design point, okay, usually it's, we consider 700 watts per square meter.
So when it's 700, the temperature of the output of the field is 88?
It depends, because you have a field, you have a closer control on the pump. So you reduce the flow rate if you want a higher temperature. Here, we can work up to 180 degrees at the outlet, okay? But sometimes we have a lower outlet because we don't want to have a very high temperature difference here. So nominally we want to work at 180 degrees, okay? But it depends also on the temperature of the tank here. See, if you have 50 degrees, you can't go to 180 here. So you have limitation of the flow rate. Okay. So, so you saw part of that in the previous presentation. So this is the field in Arca, Italy. So this is a simplified drawing. So you see here they have three lines of random collectors, 190 kilowatts peak of for the field. So it's already a middle sized collector. The thermal storage, which is a molten source, so the charging line, which is on the bottom, and the discharging on the top. So either to chill, either to produce electricity with organic plant cycle, or to do both at the same time. Okay. This is the layout in Jordan. So in Jordan, they directly store the thermal oil here in the tank to power an absorption chiller, so for cooling in summer. They bypass the absorption chiller and they directly heat here what they hold the heat water here to provide heat to the fine coil units, air handling units during the winter. And they also produce steam and electricity with a steam generator. If they overproduce, they simply dry. They simply cool down the production with by dry cooling. Though in Jordan, this facility is more, let's say, a pilot, which is operated whenever they want to make experiments. And this is the layout in Egypt, and we have someone here who is working on this platform. So they are using 115 kilowatts of solar, so just in one line here, to provide air conditioning to a medical center. So they store directly the heat transfer fluid, which is thermal oil, mineral oil. So they produce also cooling with the absorption chiller, heating with the same absorption chiller during the winter, and also they produce electricity with ORC. So organic plant insulation. So at the end, at the first draft of the STS-MED project, which has been designed mainly by ARCA, Consortio ARCA, we aim to get 400 kilowatts of thermal power, and we got a bit more, 460 kilowatt thermal. More than 1,000 technicians and experts have been involved. 20 companies have been skilled already to provide the supply chain. So basically we can already produce this kind of collectors that you see there relying on these companies. And more than 400 people have been trained to support the construction. We had like 20,000 visitors of the four platforms. We also gave support to the policymakers, because in this kind of project you can have a nice idea, but also you have to invoke them. So public entities like Sicilian region, also the Chamber of Commerce of Cyprus, and ministry, some ministries in Egypt and Jordan have been involved, and they played a role in this project. So we have now four test benches in Jordan, in Egypt, in Palermo, and here in Nicosia. They are open platforms, So here we have, for instance, a research facility. It's not the best optimized platform, but we want to operate it to see where we can reduce the cost. And also, the one in Cyprus, for instance, aims later to go to higher temperature, more than 180 degrees, but like in Italy, go to maybe 250 degrees, let's say, to fire more efficient absorption chiller. So based on this experience, we want to deploy that in the region of the Mediterranean Sea to directly provide the most important needs of buildings, which is air conditioning. But not only, also when air conditioning is not required, to produce electricity. So far, the main drawback is the low market of small size absorption chillers and also small size ORC and the efficiency. Now it's a bit better, but let's say 4 years ago, few products were available for, let's say, low power Fresnel collectors and parabolic collectors. So I want to show you what that would be. Okay. The construction phase of the Cypriot field. For then electronics and so on, you need 3 to 5 more days. Okay. But okay, it's a prototype, it's a pilot. So now, as I told you, we have now a supply chain which is a bit more mature. So obviously, it can be better. And we already saw some improvements of that can be done. So okay, we will. Visit direct the facility after lunch there. So, okay, I don't know if you have some questions regarding this presentation and the cogeneration through STS-MED project. Yes? Sorry? Yes, it's a prototype. The thing is that the double effect chillers, let's say 2-3 years ago when the project started, there were not many of them, okay? Yeah, there were not many of them. Now, there are some double effect absorption chillers with a capacity of 23 kilowatts. The operation temperature for this kind of collector, the chiller, 140-170. Okay? So, these are more demonstration units to show that we have 7, thanks to this prominent energy, we can produce cooling. That was the main purpose of this project. Now, we will operate them, improve them, and from research, we are now in development, let's say, phase, and we are almost ready to deploy this technology on other areas.
I can add something related to what I was saying yesterday, that this is a way to apply the CSP concept for the smallest case. You have seen that the mirror media has been installed by people. Just two persons are able to install one mirror. If you remember the Areva project, you have more than 2 meters mirrors, so you need cranes, you need another kind of strategy for installation. And here you are trying to bring services closer and closer to the place where you are using the energy. So the competition, if you want, of this system is with PV. But just to make a comparison, I'm working on a review of all the solar cooling technologies that we have in the market now. A PV panel has an efficiency of, let's say, 15%, from 10 to 15%.
Okay.
And you have a vacuum compression chiller with a COP of 3.5. So 15% multiplied for 3.5 is something around 0.5, okay? But if you have an absorption chiller, we are waiting for the ripple effect. There are some units, big units in the market. I hope they will come in the for smaller size. The COP is 1.8. But you have an average efficiency, the thermal efficiency of the furnace system, but you can go, of course, even to more efficient system if you have other installation conditions. It's about 0.4. So 0.4 multiplied for 1.8, it's something like 0.7, 0.75. So these kind of technologies are competing with the PV plus VC systems in an effective way. And my personal opinion is that they will coexist. That we have to think about communities where you are applying a PV, you are applying thermal, you have chillers, and maybe you have gas or other kind of thermal backups. Because this is available, and when you make calculation, this is the important point, I think, like if you want to go deeper in this. If you make calculation, it's the expansion of the size of the chiller in this kind of application is a wrong strategy. You have to stay a little bit lower the demand and smooth the peaks with gas or whatever you have. It's better, you will save about 50 or 70% of the gas, and this will be cost effective. If you are sizing the solar system at the peak, this will not work for a part of the year, so it's a wrong capital investment. Maybe solar companies are happy, but the owners of the building will pay a bill that is not justified. So we have to play also a little bit with the whatever we have around, and the idea of STS-MED was to cook this in solar field with many different systems. Yes?
So you mean the power design divided by the time of use during the year?
No, how much solar power you use regarding the power system. You know, when you design your capacity of system, and then you know how much power this building needs.
I mean the coverage of air conditioning of the building.
Yeah,
according to our calculations for the Visa, we will explore more during the visit, it's 30 to 50% of the air conditioning needs of the building. Which is, okay, low, but it will be upgraded to a double effect chiller, even triple. So you see, we have a COP with level around 1 1.1. Triple, we are more than 1.4. Some of them came 1.8, but there is the scaling problem. So obviously we'll torture more. Yes, we have, it's a matter of pressure. I was trying to find the slides. Maybe I use this one. For instance, in this one, so here we are operating up to 146 degrees. So we need to maintain the pressure below 6 bar. Yes, up to 6 bar. Here, the adsorption chiller is operating at 90 degrees, 95. So we are at lower pressure. We pressurize it, but no more than 4 bar. So we could not use directly here because there is a limitation from the adsorption chiller regarding the pressure. So that's why we need to use two separate loops. And anyway, the assertion shear, which is the limitation, cannot operate at more than 95 degrees. If not, you will damage the system. So if we provide here water at 130 degrees, we destroy the shear. Yes?
You mentioned that this was the issue in the filter.
Yes.
You mean you wanted to keep the viscous as high?
No, sorry. We want to have a turbulent flow. This is something that has been discovered by testing in the field in Italy. Is that when you have high ENI and inside the absorber it's cold. Okay. Some parts are heating more than others. Okay. You have 4 meters. The absorber is 4 meters long. Okay. So if you heat more, let's say, the belly, bends like this, or sometimes it bends like this. You understand?
Okay.
So if you have high flow rate, okay, it's more turbulent, so you have better heat exchange inside the pipe. Okay.
So you want to reduce the
yes. 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 Oh, sorry. Yes. Maybe.